Welcome back, everyone. I'm Jordan Giesige, and this is The Limiting Factor. This is the third video of the LFP series, and we're going to look at how many batteries CATL might supply to Tesla in 2025. Why 2025? It's because CATL is targeting 1,200 gigawatt hours of installed production capacity in 2025. It's expected that most of that will be a lithium iron phosphate, or LFP, chemistry. CATL's 1,200 gigawatt-hour production targets fueled a lot of speculation about how much of that production output is for Tesla and how many vehicles Tesla could produce with those cells. In my view, a lot of that speculation hasn't fully taken into account what 1,200 gigawatt hours of installed capacity means in terms of actual production on an exponential curve. Furthermore, I haven't seen estimates that include some of CATL's other customer commitments. Today I'm going to walk you through why, after factoring in those two variables, I think that the actual amount of cells that CATL will supply to Tesla will be closer to 200 gigawatt hours. I'll also walk through some numbers for what Tesla's total cell supply might look like in 2025 from all sources, and the split between energy storage and vehicle production. Before we begin, a special thanks to my Patreon supporters and YouTube members. This is the support that gives me the freedom to avoid chasing the algorithm and sponsors, and I hope will eventually allow me to do this full time. As always, the links for support are in the description. Let's start with what 1,200 gigawatt hours of installed capacity means in terms of actual production output. CATL was guiding for 110 gigawatt hours of installed capacity by the end of 2020, but their actual output was 47 gigawatt hours. That's only 43% of installed end-of-year capacity. Why is actual cell production so far below installed end-of-year capacity? In 2020, COVID would have played a part, but it would have been a minor factor. The four major reasons would be as follows. First, some of that capacity would have been installed in the final months of the year. This means that the machines weren't running for most of the year. Second, after installation, it takes about a year for production capacity to ramp and hit steady state. Third, battery factories never achieve their nameplate production capacity. Defective cells and downtime for maintenance usually result in an actual production output of 80 to 90% of nameplate production capacity. That is, 10 gigawatt hours of nameplate capacity means 8 to 9 gigawatt hours of actual production. Fourth, sometimes goals and production timelines slip. However, let's assume for this video that CATL's able to get all the materials and equipment they need on time and with no issues, allowing them to install all planned capacity between now and 2025 on schedule. Let's create a hypothetical example using this data from Panasonic as a template. If a company like CATL installed 50 gigawatt hours of production capacity in June of a given year, 2 gigawatt hours of cells would be produced in the first quarter and 4 gigawatt hours in the second quarter. That's 6 gigawatt hours of production on 50 gigawatt hours of installed capacity. If they built another 50 gigawatt hour factory in June of the second year, that would be another 6 gigawatt hours. The 50 gigawatt hour factory installed in the first year would produce 36 gigawatt hours in the second. 36 gigawatt hours for the first factory and 6 gigawatt hours for the second tallies to 42 gigawatt hours of production on 100 gigawatt hours of installed capacity. Then, in year 3, if they installed 100 gigawatt hours to double production capacity again, the tally would be 40 gigawatt hours from the first 50 gigawatt hour factory, 36 gigawatt hours from the second 50 gigawatt hour factory, and 12 gigawatt hours for the new 100 gigawatt hour factory, for a total of 88 gigawatt hours of actual production on 200 gigawatt hours of production capacity. That's a 44% utilization rate, which is close to CATL's 43% for 2020. Taking all that into account, my view is that on an exponential curve, 50% is a fair multiplier to arrive at actual production capacity versus installed capacity. The 50% multiplier means that the 1,200 gigawatt hours of capacity CATL has planned for 2025 would result in 600 gigawatt hours of actual production. How much of that 600 gigawatt hours will Tesla get? CATL is currently China's largest lithium-ion battery manufacturer. CATL will need to grow at 50% per year just to support the local Chinese manufacturers, and then will need to provide battery cells to Tesla on top of that. It looks like CATL's ambitious 1,200 gigawatt-hour plan is designed to attempt exactly that. CATL is expected to double production capacity in 2021, and nearly double production capacity in 2022. I'm taking a wild guess here, but I'm assuming they need to do a burst of capacity increases in 2021 and 2022 to create capacity for Tesla, and to a lesser extent, European manufacturers. Then, after that capacity is added, they'll grow capacity at 50% per year, allowing them to support 50% annual growth rates for Tesla, European, and Chinese manufacturers. That is, in 2025, I'm estimating that at least 50% of CATL's batteries will go to Chinese EV manufacturers. The other 50% will go to Tesla and European manufacturers, with 35% of that dedicated to Tesla and 15% for European manufacturers. How did I arrive at those numbers? Volkswagen is expecting 77 gigawatt hours of cells from CATL in 2025. 77 gigawatt hours is 6.5% of 1,200 gigawatt hours. Plus, there will be several other European manufacturers using CATL's battery cells. With that in mind, I'm estimating all of CATL's European customers combined, not just VW, will account for 15% of CATL's total production. In reality, I think it could be anywhere between 10% and 25%. A 50% China, 35% Tesla, and 15% Europe split of 600 gigawatt hours means 300 gigawatt hours for China, 210 gigawatt hours for Tesla, and 90 gigawatt hours for Europe. As always, this isn't investment advice. I'm sharing this information so you can build your own model that includes your own multiplier for capacity and factor in your own estimates for CATL's customer split. Let's assume Tesla increases cell consumption by, on average, about 60% per year, reaching 600 gigawatt hours of cell consumption by 2025. 60% is a walloping average growth rate over 4 years, given that the annual growth rate for lithium-ion batteries is 30 to 50%. A moment ago, I said that Tesla could secure 35% of CATL's potential 600 gigawatt hours of production output in 2025, which would come to 210 gigawatt hours of cells for Tesla. Let's say 200 gigawatt hours for a round number. If we take my 600 gigawatt hour estimate for 2025 minus 200 gigawatt hours from CATL, that would leave 400 gigawatt hours to be covered by Tesla's own in-house production and their cell supply from Panasonic and LG Chem. I'm estimating that Panasonic is currently producing about 48 gigawatt hours of cells for Tesla, and LG Chem roughly 22 gigawatt hours. That's a total of 70 gigawatt hours of annual production. Let's say Panasonic and LG Chem almost double that for Tesla to 120 gigawatt hours by 2025, 200 gigawatt hours from CATL, and 120 gigawatt hours from Panasonic and LG Chem would be 320 gigawatt hours. That leaves 280 gigawatt hours for Tesla to produce in-house in 2025 to hit 600 gigawatt hours. These numbers are clearly conservative. The reason my numbers are conservative is because currently, in 2021, the battery supply chain is already tight, and it's expected that will evolve into shortages in the next few years. Although Tesla's probably better prepared for shortages than any other EV or battery company, I've restricted Tesla's growth in cell consumption to a little less than 50% per year from 2024 to 2026 to accommodate the possibility. I've restricted the growth of LG Chem and Panasonic more than Tesla's growth because the cells they supply to Tesla are nickel-based. Battery-grade nickel is difficult to source, and I expect nickel-based battery chemistries to ramp more slowly than LFP batteries, which use readily available iron. I expect that, as Tesla has indicated, their production will include iron-based cells, setting them up for a faster production ramp than LG Chem and Panasonic. Tesla's Giga Berlin and Giga Austin are slated to eventually produce between 200 to 250 gigawatt-hours of cells each. So if Tesla does get access to plenty of nickel or ramps LFP quickly, we could see much more out of Tesla than 280 gigawatt-hours in 2025. Note, this is cell consumption and not vehicle production. Vehicle production ramps will continue at pace as Tesla pushes into the compact vehicle segment, which uses smaller battery packs. As an interim summary, my finger-in-the-wind estimate for Tesla's cell supply from all sources in 2025 is 600 gigawatt-hours. 47%, or 280 gigawatt-hours, will come from Tesla's in-house production. 33%, or 200 gigawatt-hours, will come from CATL. And 20%, or 120 gigawatt-hours, will come from LG and Panasonic. What are the unknowns, and how do they affect the accuracy of my estimate? First, we don't know the number of battery factories Tesla intends on having installed in 2025. So far, we know of two, and there may be more planned. Second, Tesla is currently buying cells from at least three companies. Tesla could also purchase from the likes of BYD, Samsung, or SK Innovation. Third, when Elon says a gigawatt hour of installed capacity, does he mean before factoring in yield losses or after? For Berlin and Austin alone, this could result in a range of between 400 to 500 gigawatt hours for actual cell production based on a potential 500 gigawatt hours of combined installed capacity at those sites. Fourth, the energy density of battery cells could increase by 10 to 20% by 2025. Higher energy density means a reduction in the raw materials needed per gigawatt hour of cell production. Fifth, as mentioned earlier, and most important to me, is raw materials availability. Taken as a group, these factors compound the uncertainty of forecasting to such a great extent that any forecast, including mine, that goes beyond a two-year horizon should be taken with a large grain of salt. A forecast is only as good as its assumptions. I'm assuming that Tesla will run into raw material shortages for their in-house production, but will be able to mitigate that by leveraging their market dominance with raw material suppliers and with other battery cell manufacturers. Overall, the 60% annual growth rate I've indicated over the next 4 years for cell consumption is justifiable based on the information we have today and Tesla's track record. Tesla's claim of 50% or more growth rate for the foreseeable future is the base case. There is a potential for a much higher growth rate, but I'd need more information on Tesla's access to nickel beyond 2022. The timeline for their in-house LFP chemistry, and their access to lithium beyond 2024. If Tesla ramps LFP without hiccups and they have access to raw materials through 2025, Tesla could ramp faster than a 60% average annual growth rate for cell supply. If they sign contracts with other battery suppliers as well, like BYD, Samsung, or SK Innovation, they'll shoot the lights out. Finally, what does 600 gigawatt hours mean in terms of actual vehicle production? In my forecast, I've said 5.3 million vehicles. This is down from 650 gigawatt hours and 7 million vehicles per year that I suggested in May. The reason for this change is because several of Tesla's vehicle ramps have been delayed, and it appears Tesla's getting into energy storage in a bigger way and more quickly than I expected. Overall, the change from 650 to 600 gigawatt-hours is a difference in compound annual growth rate from 64% to 60%. I'm primarily focused on cell supply rather than vehicle production because cell supply can be used for both energy storage and vehicle production. Each of those two product areas has its own economics, and I'll be interested to see which is more profitable per gigawatt-hour in 2025. With that in mind, on screen is what a rough split could look like for vehicles and energy storage in 2025. I'm looking forward to revisiting this in a couple of years. The view for 2025 should be much clearer by 2023. The biggest wild cards for me are the Semi and Cybertruck. They'll have the biggest battery packs and they'll use a lot of nickel. If I've been too aggressive with the Semi and Cybertruck, then I'd expect closer to 6 million vehicles instead of 5.3, or 200 gigawatt hours of energy storage instead of 155. In summary, CATL's target of 1,200 gigawatt hours of installed capacity by 2025 shouldn't be taken at face value. Judging by the ongoing gap between production capacity and actual production on an exponential curve, 600 gigawatt hours of actual production is more likely. Of that 600 gigawatt hours, my view is that Tesla will get up to 33%, or 200 gigawatt hours. 50% or more will go to Chinese EV manufacturers, with the remainder going to European auto manufacturers. In addition to the 200 gigawatt hours of LFP cells from CATL, Tesla could produce 280 gigawatt hours of cells in-house and secure another 120 gigawatt hours from other suppliers. This would lead to a grand total of 600 gigawatt hours of cells consumed by Tesla in 2025, a 60% annual growth rate from today. Those cells could be used in a number of ways, but my current view is that they'll be used to produce around 5 million vehicles and around 150 gigawatt hours of energy storage products. An argument can be made for a growth rate of more or less than 60% per year over the next 4 years. My view is 60% until Tesla provides guidance on raw materials, LFP progress, or additional battery supply contracts. I expect growth to be closer to 75% for the next 2 years. Then, as raw material shortages create drag, moderated growth of around 50% in the mid-2020s. Again, that's cell consumption, not profit or vehicle production, which I expect to continue at 50% or more. Elon's advised that for the foreseeable future, vehicle production will grow at 50% or more, and also indicated that the energy storage business will grow at greater than 100% per year. I interpret the foreseeable future as 2 to 3 years. The variables I've laid out today look just beyond the horizon, because it felt like material supply and the actual production capacity of Tesla's cell suppliers was missing from the conversation. Even if my forecasts are incorrect, these factors will be two of the primary determinants for Tesla's evolution between now and 2025. There are at least two videos yet to come in the LFP series. The next video will cover BYD LFP. But before that, I'll be releasing the next video of the Gigacasting series and my How a Battery Works video, so expect the BYD LFP video to come out in mid-December. If you enjoyed this video, please consider supporting me on Patreon with the link at the end of the video. I'm also active on Twitter. You can find the details in the description, and I look forward to hearing from you. A special thanks to Jason Bishop, Jason Kapadia, Euler Gamma, Kevin Basilek, Justin Charon, and Fon Tomas for your generous support of the channel, my YouTube members, and all the other patrons listed in the credits. I appreciate all your support, and thanks for tuning in.